All right. So Takushi gave a very nice overview of the history and the future of transcatheter valves. My job is to talk about the here and now. So what we're going to do in the next 20 minutes or so is review the device, review the evidence, talk about the inoperable patient and the high-risk patient, and review a case. So what we're talking about as the currently only approved valve in the United States is the Sapien transcatheter heart valve manufactured by Edwards Life Sciences. It was first FDA approved in November of 2011 by unanimous panel approval. It's a balloon expandable stainless steel frame with three bovine pericardial leaflets, as he had mentioned. And what's really important about this valve, it's got this fabric skirt at the lower, sort of the caudal half of this. And that's what helps not only provide reinforcement, but really its intent is to seal the valve against the annulus and avoid paravalvular leak. It's mounted on a balloon. This is called a Retroflex 3 system. This device is basically a balloon catheter that has a deflectable component to it to allow it to transition across the aortic arch seamlessly. It's not so seamless. It's pretty stiff, in fact. So this is the transfemoral approach and animation of this. You know, the room is set up. We have a number of people in the room, and we'll show you some photographs of that in a minute. We have perfusion ready with a wet pump ready to go, surgeons in the room. And the transfemoral approach, as you'll see, is sort of the default approach because of improved quality of life and reduced hospital stay. But nevertheless, it's performed in our institution by percutaneous puncture. First task is to get a wire across the aortic valve. And then over that same wire, we put in a balloon catheter. This is simply just to make space for the next device. So this is just a balloon aortic valvuloplasty being demonstrated here. You'll see that the heart is kind of in a standstill. That's because of rapid pacing. We pace at rates between 160 and 200 beats per minute to create low pulsatility of the heart to avoid things moving around. Then the Sapien sheath is advanced up into the descending aorta, and subsequently the Sapien delivery system on the Retroflex catheter is advanced over that same stiff guide wire into the annulus position. Rapid pacing is again commenced, and the valve is deployed. And at this time, the balloon is deflated and everything comes out, and this is kind of when everyone kind of suspends animation and waits to see what's going to happen. The key task here is the silent person in the sort of towards the head of the bed, which is the echocardiographer, trying to determine whether or not there's any paravalvular leak, whether all the three leaflets are working properly, whether one of the leaflets, which can happen, they can get stuck and cause torrential aortic regurgitation. We're ready to be primed under the chest if we need to open the chest to deal with an embolized valve or to deal with severe aortic regurgitation. The transfemoral access requires that you have patent femoral arteries bilaterally. Currently, the delivery system is advanced through 22 and 24 French sheaths for the two sizes of valves that are commercially available. We're now using, we started off doing a lot of cut downs, but we found that the morbidity associated with that and sort of length of stay was a little bit long. So we're now really primarily using a percutaneous approach and pre-closing the artery using the suture delivery system called the ProStar device. But now there are some patients that are just not candidates for a transfemoral approach. This is one example of an angiogram of a patient for whom a large sheath would just not go through this tortuous calcified artery. And for those, the transapical approach is done. So structurally at our institution, we have two surgeons at the left side of the chest working on getting access and delivering and deploying the valve. The cardiologist is on the right side of the table doing the inflation, but also working the X-ray system as well. More recently, the transaortic approach has been described. This is a procedure that's familiar to almost all cardiac surgeons, well, to all cardiac surgeons. A small incision in the right upper sternal border, as Dr. Kohmoto mentioned, with a direct access to the aorta. It still remains to be seen whether or not this is going to kind of surpass the transapical approach. This approach has not been sort of studied in any sort of randomized fashion, but has a number of advantages, most namely that you do not have to invade the myocardium. And so let's stop there and let's pause and let's review the evidence behind everything I just mentioned. So that's the currently available valve. So where things really started was the experience in Europe where this Sapien valve had been used for a number of years, but not in really any sort of randomized fashion. It was not until the partner trials, plural, when the pivotal decision was made to approve this valve. And the partner trials deserve some mention because they were really well done. So these are patients with symptomatic severe aortic valve stenosis, a total of 1,000 patients, and there were really, the partner trials were really two cohorts. The first cohort was an inoperable cohort, that's the cohort B. Those are patients who were deemed inoperable for surgical valve replacement. And the other cohort was the high-risk cohort, where surgeons could conceivably do the surgery, but understand that that patient would be considered high-risk. And these are they're individually powered sort of cohorts, 700 patients in the high-risk, 358 in the inoperables. The inoperables were designed exclusively for a transfemoral approach. So if you did not have adequate vascular conduits up through the legs, that you were not included. So as long as you had a good transfemoral access, you were then randomized to the transfemoral TAVR versus standard therapy with a primary endpoint as all-cause mortality at 1 year. The distinction between inoperable and high risk is challenging. There's also that cohort C that we talk about. These are patients that are just beyond reproach. You know, not even TAVR is going to save them. But nevertheless, the executive committee decided that the term inoperable really was to be defined by this: the risk of death or serious irreversible morbidity of AVR, surgical AVR, is assessed by a cardiologist and two cardiac surgeons independently seen on two separate visits. Must exceed 50%. It didn't just stop here. This trial also revolutionized this concept of independent adjudication. These cases were then sent to the executive committee, who then had to agree that these patients, who they were presented, were truly inoperable and candidates for the trial. So who is considered inoperable? There are a number of anatomic factors and a number of medical factors. Some of the anatomic factors are listed here: the porcelain aorta, severe chest wall deformity. That's the relative percentage of patients that comprise the cohort that did end up getting got randomized. Their medical factors include oxygen-dependent respiratory failure, but also just this sort of difficult to kind of put your hands around term called frailty. Most cardiac surgeons do an eyeball test, but you can do a number of more objective measures, the grip strength, albumin measurements, the 5-meter walk time, and so on. So these are all sort of a more trying to get your hand around this concept of frailty. And of course, we have the scores, the STS score and the Euro score, which help stratify patients in terms of operative mortality. And that can be helpful, but don't necessarily encompass all of the nuances related to what's considered an operative candidate. And in terms of the exclusion criteria, these valves had to be calcified tri-leaflet aortic valves. The bicuspid, unicuspid, or other valve concepts, even a bioprosthetic valve in this particular trial, was excluded. The reason being is that fabric skirt has to hold on to something. You know, you have to have something to hold on to. It has to be firm fibrous and calcific tissue with the leaflets. And if you don't have that, so, as in many patients with bicuspid aortic valve stenosis, there would be a very high risk of paravalvular leak or worse, embolization. If you needed coronary artery vascularization as a result, in addition to your AVR, you're excluded. There were some annulus diameter ranges that you had to have because there were only two valves, a 23-millimeter and a 26-millimeter, that were being tested. And you had to have suitable femoral access, as mentioned before, an aortic iliac access. And, of course, you could not have any sort of terminal illness that would have limited your life expectancy. And these are the baseline characteristics. Complicated slide, but just focusing on these. The mean age of these patients was in the range of 83 years. Most patients had class 3, class 4 heart failure symptoms, so very symptomatic. And between a third and a half of patients had previous thoracotomy before CABG. In terms of what does standard medical therapy, well, we all know in medical school there is no medical therapy for aortic valve stenosis. Balloon aortic valvuloplasty at best should be considered palliative, but they were applied in the standard therapy group. Heart failure medications were applied, primarily diuretics as needed. And so the primary endpoint was all-cause mortality, and if you look at the intention to treat curve, the Kaplan-Meier curve here, you'll see a startling significant reduction in mortality. In blue, the TAVR group compared to yellow, which is the standard therapy group. And that translates into a number needed to treat at 1 year of 5 patients. And if you compare that against other standard approaches that we use in cardiovascular medicine, for example, aspirin, you need to treat 40 patients to prevent a death at 1 year. And if you then take another device, an expensive device like an implantable cardiac defibrillator, you need to treat 15 patients to prevent a death at 1 year for secondary prevention. So what about repeat hospitalization? Well, again, it was statistically significantly improved, remarkably so. The TAVR group was not hospitalized as much or as frequently. And if you then combine mortality or hospitalization, repeat hospitalization as a combination, then your number needed to treat was 3 to avoid both of those endpoints. So in the other things that I don't have time to kind of go through in detail is that TAVR also improved quality of life measures, a 6-minute walk test, quality of life, and a subjective New York Heart Association class. It did come at a price, though. There was a slight increased risk of stroke in the trial with the TAVR group, as you can see here. This is listed by time from discharge, so less than 30 days, the patient's, time from valve implant, rather. There was an increased risk of stroke in the TAVR group compared to standard therapy. That risk was not really seen beyond 30 days when you compared the two groups, so it's really an upfront early risk. And most of these strokes were hemorrhagic strokes. Ischemic strokes, rather. If you looked at the paravalvular incidence of paravalvular leak, a concept that surgeons have known for years is detrimental in terms of the longevity of the valve, there did not seem to be a major significant increase in death over time, whether or not you had mild or moderate, none or mild paravalvular leak, or moderate or severe. But what is notable is in that early period, there was a significant increase. Now, what's not really reflected here is the fact is those who had severe paravalvular leak were subsequently treated, so there was kind of a crossover effect that you might be seeing there. But nevertheless, if you look at this from an intention to treat perspective, there did not seem to be anything that panned out in this inoperable cohort. If you look at the durability of the valve, now we've only got data published out to 3 years. The valve seems to be quite durable. This is the yellow is the effective orifice area, and blue is the mean gradient. And so the mean gradient stays low and persists out to 3 years, and effective orifice area is as well increased and stable. So in conclusion, for the inoperable cohort, there was a significant reduction in mortality, less disability associated with TAVR. Reduced hospitalization, and the valve is durable to 3 years. However, caution because there is a small early hazard for stroke in that first 30 days. So let's switch gears. That was the inoperable cohort. The partner trial was again divided into two, and so we'll talk about the high-risk cohort. The high-risk cohort was designed such that it preferentially recruited patients to the transfemoral group if you were eligible. So if you had adequate vascular access, you were shuttled into a transfemoral randomization. The transfemoral TAVR was compared against surgical AVR in that particular randomization. If you did not have adequate vascular conduits, then you were then shuttled into the transapical randomization. And then the primary endpoint was, again, all-cause mortality at 1 year. And so if you look at this, if you look at it in totality, these are the Kaplan-Meier statistics. This was a non-inferiority design because it's a high-risk cohort comparing against the standard approach. And the curves are pretty much on top of each other, suggesting statistically significantly so that TAVR was considered non-inferior to surgical AVR. And this is showing this reflected as an intention to treat as well as an as treated. Because of this worry that there might be crossovers, it didn't really matter whether you analyze one or the other. So significantly in favor of this being a non-inferior therapy. If you look at the one-year hazard rates, again, caution, because there was an increased risk of stroke with TAVR against the surgical AVR. Most of those strokes happened, again, in the first 30 days. The risk of major stroke was still higher than the surgical AVR group as all comers, but that was not statistically significant, though a trend. The risk of major vascular complications was definitely higher in the TAVR group, primarily driven by the transfemoral randomization group. However, when you look at totality, the risk of major bleeding that was transfusion requiring surgical AVR was higher on that front. So in terms of the high risk patient, the STS, the kind of the way to think about this is that by STS criteria, the inoperable cohort was a sort of STS estimated mortality risk of 15% or higher. And for this high risk is 10 to 15%. Is in that kind of range, is kind of the ballpark. But again, not everything is reflected by STS. So in terms of local practice, this is how we started off. Again, the valve was approved in the United States in November of 2011. It wasn't until early 2012 that we got approval to start and started. So a patient is referred to our multidisciplinary valve clinic. This is being an operator of this, the biggest challenge is to identify the right patient. And I think most surgeons or proceduralists in the room understand that, yes, there are some technical factors, but I think really honing in and identifying the right patient is key, and it requires a team effort. All patients have to undergo a cardiac catheterization and need to be revascularized. And the reason for this is because if we do rapid pacing at 180 beats per minute or 200 beats per minute, we have to know that they'll be able to come off pacing with a reasonable cardiac function. And if they've got underlying high-grade disease that's going to cause ischemia and create a kind of a spiral, as patients with aortic stenosis can get, then that's not a good thing. And so we try to revascularize the major coronary arteries as best as we can. All patients, as per any valve surgery, require dental clearance and nutrition assessment, pre-op anesthesia assessment, and then in the procedure. For transfemoral patients, we have our kind of protocol is that those patients get done in the hybrid cath lab and get sent to F4, M5 for their recovery. The transapical or transaortic patients go to B4-5, kind of structurally for recovery. And then in terms of post-op clinic visits, we see them at 1, 6, and 12 months. For some people are coming in from a long distance, we can skip the six-month one and let their local cardiologist see them there. But we do need the 1 and 12 months for the National TAVR Registry for which we are participating in. So let's just talk about a case. This is a typical case, a 91-year-old woman that we saw back in February earlier. She has a severe symptomatic aortic valve stenosis. Those are her mean gradients, peak gradients, and aortic valve areas. And here are the ranges here, what's considered severe. So severe. She has a number of other surgeries in the past. And she presented in February 2012 with a heart failure exacerbation, got hospitalized, was kind of diuresed and treated adequately and sent to us, referred for TAVR. She was deemed inoperable by a local surgeon and then subsequently by two of our surgeons, as her STS score was about 15%, but primarily her major reason for inoperability was her age and frailty. She was, by definition, New York Heart Association Class 4 because she never really fully recovered from this heart failure exacerbation. And so this is the angiogram showing multiple things. First of all, you'll notice that there's a transesophageal echo probe helping to monitor the case. We have a temporary transvenous pacer wire lodged in the right ventricle. We've got a wire coming up from the femoral artery up the aorta and around, retrograde through the aortic valve. And what's going on right now is a balloon valvuloplasty with the valve annular plane about there. And then what we're seeing here is a pigtail catheter injecting contrast into the aortic root, and the coronary arteries shown here, the wire here, and we have an undeployed valve ready and poised in kind of a perfect position, 40% more proximal and 60% more distal to the annular plane. We then deploy the valve and redo an aortogram showing no evidence of aortic insufficiency. The valve in full up position here and well deployed and aligned. And what's also important, it's not compromising any of the coronary arteries, the ostia of those. And then at the end of the case, again, we typically use the ProStar device and do a final angiogram post closure, demonstrating an intact artery. So here are some of the landmarks for our institution. So our first transfemoral case was done in January of 2012. We then went on to, there was a delay in the approval process for the transapical because of some concerns about some hazard that was seen in the partner one cohort A group, the high risk group. But nevertheless, that was approved, and we then started that in November of 2012. In light of the influx of cases, we realized early that we would need another room to do this. We started off doing this in OR22, but now have our own room as well. That was in April 2013. And then we thought that there's kind of a fellowship of people who are doing these procedures in Wisconsin that we need to learn from, and they can learn from us. And so we hosted the first Wisconsin Valve Symposium in September of 2013, which was a huge success. And we did our first transaortic case fairly recently in September of this year as well. So of the total number of cases, we've done 39 transfemoral cases, 27 transapicals, one transaortic. We've done four valve-in-valve cases, and then there's this second set of trials coming up. The second trial is called a partner trial, and the partner two trial is kind of the follow-on to partner one. Now looking at the intermediate cohort. So we talked about inoperable, we talked about high risk, and now we're getting into the intermediate cohort. And so to dial that in, that's a cohort that's estimated to have an STS score of between 4% and 10% in that range, again, deemed intermediate. And that one's using the next generation device, which is not approved, but Takushi had mentioned it, called the Sapien XT device, which is a lower profile, a better platform, and hopefully will result in better outcomes. The mean age of the patients that we've so far done is about 82, and that's the range there. There have been six deaths up to a year, but nothing within 30 days. We've had a number of major vascular complications, eight, and this is most of this was all in our upfront and early period. There's definitely a learning curve with this, and I would say we haven't really had anything in the last 6 months. We had two embolized valves. One required emergency pump and extraction through a transapical approach. It was a phenomenal case. That patient ended up surviving the discharge, but didn't do so very well because when they repaired the apex of the heart, the heart was kind of shrunk, and the patient was left with a kind of a persistent degree of diastolic or heart failure. But nevertheless, has survived for some period of time. What's not listed here that there was, this got left off of this slide. So there were five total strokes and TIAs if you combine the two, but none of these really left with any residual neurologic defect on discharge. Severe paravalvular leak, there was none. There's five moderate cases, and those patients seem to be doing fine. The rest of them are either mild or none paravalvular leak. And there we go. So these are kind of the team. This is the heart team, and a number of people are involved in this team approach. it has to be this way. And I think we've worked very well, and we've, you know, demonstrated by these excellent outcomes, which are far better than anything that was reported in the trials. And we seem to be in the sort of 90-plus percentile when it comes to looking at the TAVR registry across other like institutions. You know, we all have our jobs, and when we're in there, we all know kind of our steps, and we have a coordinated pattern, and it's quite a well-orchestrated machine now. And you know, you see Lucian and Germa together working initially on a cut down at one point. So in summary, off-pump TAVR is indicated for the inoperable patient or high-risk patient with calcific tri-leaflet aortic valve stenosis. It does require a multidisciplinary heart team approach, I think, for optimal outcomes. That's been well established now. You know, in the future, we're going to see better valve concepts. It's just going to get better and better. Right now, we're dealing with 22 French and 24 French delivery systems for the commercial system. The Sapien XT, which is the next generation valve, which is currently in that trial, Partner 2, is 18 French and 20 French. Short of that, there will be 16 French systems coming down the pipe, which are already being implemented in Europe right now. And so I think it's just going to get exciting to be part of this, and an exciting time for cardiology and cardiac surgery. And here's a smattering of the team. And I think that's it. And I'll stop there and answer any questions that you have.